excuse me. Yeah, thank you all for coming in such large numbers. Those of us who work on early modern history are usually not expecting that kind of outer turnout, but it may have something to do with the charisma of the speaker today. His name is Giancarlo Casale, and while that sounds Italian, he's in fact from Madison, I understand, this morning. And he's an associate professor of history, more particularly the Middle Eastern part of Middle Eastern history, at the University of Minnesota. Today, he will discuss, in case you're wondering why we invited him for a South Asian seminar, he will discuss his work on the Indian Ocean. You may have seen his book, which came out this year, a revised dissertation which he defended at Harvard in 2004, and which is called The Ottoman Age of Exploration. If you're familiar with the subject, the Ottomans are usually considered the losers of the 16th century in the Indian Ocean, but our speaker today is going to defend the opposite point of view, if I'm correct. Yeah, the book has immense appeal. I like it myself quite a lot, not only because it's iconoclastic, but it's also an extremely good read. And I'm not surprised to learn this morning again that it is listed for as a finalist for 2010 Kundal Prize in History, which is, in fact, the biggest history prize in the world.
Everybody keep your fingers crossed.
Being a finalist is pretty good, even if you don't get it. But we all hope, of course, that you will. Professor Casale is not only the author of this book, he is also working on a new project which has to do with the history of the sea, a social history of the sea, which is a special issue of the Journal of Early Modern History, of which he is now, since a couple of weeks, the executive editor.
Just enough time for somebody to threaten to sue me.
Oh, okay.
Nice introduction to the job.
Yes, well, you have to be careful with these things. And in addition to that, he's working on another interesting book called Curiosity and Tolerance, The Paradox of Early Modernity. I'm very happy to have a speaker on the Indian Ocean. We usually don't think about the Indian Ocean very much, but if you read global strategy journals and geopolitical publications, you'll find that the great number of people that are expecting the Indian Ocean to become the most important part of the world for American foreign politics and for global change in general. I recommend, now that we are talking about the Indian Ocean, I recommend Robert Parker's book that came out last week called Monsoon. It makes exactly this point. And also brings up all these early empires, talks a great deal about the 16th century as the beginning of the age of global empires in this area. This is an excellent opportunity to make up for our past negligence of the Indian Ocean, I would say, and I would like to suggest you start right away. Please welcome Giancarlo Casale.
Thank you very much.
I think I will move this so I can.
I know I have some fancy remote control, but I'm not quite. Never mind. So it's a pleasure for me to be here. I am from Madison, as you have now learned, but this is the first time I have ever been at the University of Wisconsin in any official capacity whatsoever. We have here my mother and stepfather in the audience. This is the first time they've had a chance to participate in any of my demonstrations of my accumulated knowledge, so it's very exciting for me to be here. The original idea when Professor Vink invited me was for me to talk about my book, but I've been working on that for such a long time that I couldn't really bear the thought of only talking about that. And this is the first time that I'm really talking to an audience of South Asianists. So what I'm going to do today is talk about something that's related to the material in my book, but also sort of connected to something that I'm working on now, and as you'll see in the end, also, I hope, of interest specifically to people who are working in the field of South Asian studies. So, we'll see how things go. The subject of my talk is the Indian Ocean, the Ottoman Empire, and the dialectic of universal sovereignty. I know that people who work on South Asia are very well known for being theoretically sophisticated, and so I threw in that term dialectical there. This is for your benefit. It's not one that I usually use, but I think it is useful, even though I'm using it in a way that is relatively primitive compared to the way that some of you might use it. And that's something that we can talk about in the end. But the basic problem that I want to start out by addressing is the problem of the caliphate. The caliphate is something that you probably all have heard of, but it's also something that is a little bit difficult for us to get a grasp on as historians. If you do a Google search, start out as simple as possible, if you could do a Google search of caliphate, first thing that's going to come up is something that looks like this. And this is certainly one meaning of the word caliphate, is the first Muslim empire. So here you can see it expanding vigorously out of the Arabian Peninsula, and eventually it grows to encompass all of the Middle East and parts of Europe, stretching from Spain on one side all the way to the borders of South Asia on the other side. So that's one way to think about the caliphate. Of course, originally it was something slightly different. The word caliph comes from the Arabic term khalifa, which simply means successor. And the original idea was that upon the death of the Prophet Muhammad, who was both a prophet and the political leader of the Muslim community,